Yeah, when we're out on the road, yeah, certainly, yeah.
But not at the
ceremony. Oh, yeah, in the ceremony. It's, yeah. Well, I mean, I'm smudging everybody, but I'm not really, you know, I'm not elder, so I can't bless the water. Well, I can bless the pot of water, but hopefully Roseanne is going to be here.
Here are the words.
Oh, good.
Nice and big. Oh, yeah. Yeah. That's right.
Yep, like
that.
Okay.
So here we are. What is it today? December
14th.
No, 16th, and we just came from the council chambers, and Gord McKay, maybe you can tell me a little bit about what happened there today.
Certainly. This is the second meeting of this particular committee, and this committee is tasked with pulling together a strategy and direction for waste management within the county. I represent Zero Waste Simcoe, and also have an interest in making sure that it has zero waste, which is one of the basic principles guiding this whole committee. So we had a very robust discussion, I guess is the best way to say it. There's some people that don't fully grasp zero waste and they're not sure how it's going to apply. There's a lot of uncertainty in their mind as to, is it real, or is it going to happen within the next 5 years? So the question was, shouldn't we be doing systems here that we're more comfortable with, such as energy from waste, or making sure we've got good disposal? Mm-hmm. So there was some heated discussion around that, and we decided not to adopt, first of all, the zero waste vision.
Well, today I was very hopeful that the Zero Waste Initiative would have really taken hold in the focus of this meeting. I don't think so. I heard gentle words from the county. However, to me the focus from the county and the Stantec was, let's get at it, and zero waste is something that's not really real. It's out there. And the government, you don't know what they're going to do, and they're saying, they're promising, we got a plan, we got based on what we have going for us. And they totally ignored the vision presented by Gord McKay.
And can you maybe tell a little bit about what that vision was?
That would be to really focus on zero waste.
It would look so good on his arm, eh?
Oh, strong. Come on.
You can pick my purse up and hold it for me.
Just
follow me around and hold it for me.
Yeah, walk it back.
So I saw yesterday when the decisions were read, you were in tears. Explain to me, that feeling, that emotion.
I was really ecstatic in the fact that it's taken so long to come to this day. It definitely is I like to think of it as the start of a new beginning. I really had to come to terms with what had happened over the past year and, between County Council and between the opposition of Site 41. And we were really viewed as enemies most of the time, enemies of County Council. And today marks a new beginning, and I'm hoping that sort of stipulation against the Site 41 opponents will be removed and we can start the healing process and work together. Because ultimately we are all on the same page and we all want what's best for the environment and for the people of the County of Simcoe as well as their surrounding First Nations. So I'm hoping to no longer be marked as an opponent or a villain in this against the County of Simcoe, and I'm hoping that they're going to drop the lawsuit and the injunction against me today. So
now, just explain how important these decisions were today. How important is this?
Well, this for us is definitely a victory because we really went out to go and ensure that water was going to be protected. Although this is not a guarantee that the water there will be protected, we definitely stopped landfill development today, and that was a good step forward in the right direction. However, there's still pending litigation with Steve Ogden and the Information Privacy Commissioner's review. So that's still ongoing, and I think if we're really going to come out into the open, I am hoping that it is in the best interest of County Council to direct Janivar to release the calibrated mod flow at Site 41 so that we're all on the same page and we all know what decisions went into having the certificate of approval be issued. So these are something that some of the things that we're going to be continuing to look at. The momentum of Site 41 is not going to die, but this is definitely a step forward in the right direction. So I'm very pleased with today's report.
Result of the Walker inquiry. It was one of Justice O'Connor's recommendations that we make this happen. And the reason is, why we're getting now into water mains across the province, like what would be in Elmville or Midland or Penetanguishene or wherever there's water mains. And what's happened in some of these older water systems, and you hear about it the odd time in the city of Toronto, where there will be a 3-foot pipe break and it'll flood out a street, the basements are full, and they find out when they do a cutout of those pipes, that some of the pipes have got like it's a 24-inch pipe, there may be 6 inches of a heavy iron on the inside right around it. So the pipe's cut down to a 12-inch main. And it slowly builds up over the years. And the Sustainable Water Act is a bill that would slowly replace and put a program in place to make sure those mains were changed over a period of time so that that bacteria or the iron bacteria that was in some of those pipes wouldn't be a problem. The other problem they got is there's so much leakage in the system. When you've got an old water system like that, I understand that there's something like, in the city of Toronto, I could be wrong on this, something like almost 1 million liters a day leaks into the ground out of the water mains just in Toronto alone. So the idea is, you know, that's bad for the environment too. You've got good, clean, treated water leaking into the ground. And so Kaplan, I don't know why Kaplan brought that bill forward, but he had to resign from cabinet. And the next thing you know, he's got this controversial water bill that the government probably didn't want to hear anything about. But really, the government you have to support that bill, and there are problems with the bill, no question about it. The Council of Canadians, who supported Site 41 100%, they have real problems with that particular bill. But as I said in the House the other day, I actually spoke on the bill on Thursday afternoon, and I said, I paid a compliment to Maude Barlow and the gang at the Council of Canadians. I said, well, if it wasn't for them, we probably wouldn't have had nearly the action we got at Site 41. So we owe them a great deal of gratitude for their work. And you know, if we have this Catholics bill come forward and it gets called as well, then that's something that, you know, the Council of Canadians can come and say, well, this, we got a problem with this, this, and this in the bill, and AMO, the Association of Municipalities of Ontario, they have a bunch of problems with the bill as well. And you know what? But in the end, the bill is required, it is needed, and I think it's the right thing to do, but you know, it may need a number of major amendments, and that's where I know it's a long answer, Don, to my question.
So they call it an application for investigation or an application for review. Now, application for investigation is pretty straightforward, as much as you would anticipate just by from its name. If you have, you have to file like two residents of Ontario, each one. But if you have evidence that some kind of piece of legislative environmental legislation is being violated, and for some reason the ministry responsible is not doing the job, or has done a bad job, or whatever, if they're not doing it, it's not happening, then you can file through my office a request for investigation and provide the evidence you have to support that. And that goes through me, goes to the ministries involved. They have to become accountable. They have 60 days to consider this, and they can come back and have to say, okay, we're going to do the investigation or not. If we're going to do it, we'll let you know when we finish. But if we're not going to do the investigation, they have to give reasons why they're not. And that brings out the public forum, and I oversee and review them. So if they're going to refuse to, at least we know why, and at least they're on the public record, and then this is subject to my review and criticism in that regard. We don't have a lot of investigation, we do have some. I'll talk about a couple of examples. Where's my book? But more importantly, the more important one is the request for review. Any two citizens of Ontario can request that the review of any act, regulation, policy, or instrument, that's like license and permits, that relate to the environment, if you feel that they are not adequately protecting the environment, you have good reason to believe they're not. Or you can ask for a review of the need for something that doesn't exist by way of an act, regulation, policy, or license or permit. And this is a very powerful tool, and a lot of NGOs use this to get the government to respond to something that has to be changed or to create something new. The process is just the same as investigation. You file this up, two people have to file it. You file this application, comes to my office, it goes to the ministry or several ministries sometimes that may be involved in this, and they have 60 days to respond. And they can either do it, and that's fine, and take some time to do it and get the report back, or they can choose not to do it, but they have to give reasons. And they give reasons, and those reasons are subject to my report. Now,
about our water system, and our agenda today is to talk about where we get our water from, our objectives with the city, the treatment of the water, monitoring and control, the distribution system, and a little bit about customer service, and then the regulatory requirements that we have to follow. Okay. Just a basic idea of how a basic water system is set up. As you can see, this is just showing the source into a treatment facility, up to a storage, out to the distribution mains. It may require a booster pumping station to get into different areas of town, and just a general overview. I have a map of our system, which I also have a larger version here for you to see. We can talk about it afterwards. We have a multi-barrier approach to safe drinking water. We try and provide barriers that eliminate threats and minimize impacts in the area. The failure of one barrier does not always jeopardize the public health and safety. Some of the barriers that we have are source water protection. We try and communicate to the public to prevent putting pollutants onto the ground, which will seep into the ground and create problems. We have our treatment process that we put out to treat the water before it goes out to the public. In our distribution system, we have a couple of programs to maintain the water quality in the pipes and also to keep the disinfection at a level that is effective.